So look at this slide. Okay, now once you get over the fact that Art's holding a huge fish, look at Art. Look at how he's holding that huge fish. You see, Art sent me this slide after he had been fishing. This is Art Ando. He used to be a primary faculty for us in back education and training. And I called him up and I said, Art, can I put this in my BET presentation? He goes, well, yes, but why do you want to do that? I said, Art, look at yourself. I said, anyone else would have been holding that fish and bending backwards and really extending their back to get the tail of the fish off the ground, but not you, Art. You see, you're standing there automatically holding that fish with your legs bent, but not your back. You see, Art has mastered the strategies of efficient posture and movement. They happen automatically for him. That's our goal with our patient. So how do we teach our patients to be automatic like Art? How do we instill these strategies in our patient? How do we teach them principles that they can use no matter what activity of daily living they are attempting to accomplish? We teach them principles or strategies, not specific movements or postures or how to hold a muscle in its contracted state. We teach them strategies that allow them to function in activities of daily living normally and without thinking about their body. We teach them strategies that allow all of this to happen automatically. We're going to do a brief overview now of the strategies, the core first strategies, that we will be using all weekend long in our core first strategy seminar together. So let's look together, first of all, at a list of these strategies. We're going to be looking at base of support, alignment, lumbar protective mechanism, weight shift, and weight acceptance. Let's look first at the number one and most important strategy and principle related to appropriate posture and movement, and that is base of support. Our base of support should serve as a foundation for the structure above. Number one, if you think about a building, or a sculptor, whatever you think about that requires weight distribution through it, it needs to have an efficient base of support. If you're building a home, when you go to get your plans approved, the number one thing that they're going to look at and evaluate is, does the foundation provide appropriate support for the structure you're wanting to build? But yet, if you talk to your patient and you're talking to them about posture or alignment, and you say, stand up straight, all they think about is straightening their alignment. They don't sit there and think, okay, to have good alignment, where are my feet? Where is my pelvis? They're not thinking about the base. And yet, any alignment that is done separate of the base simply creates another holding pattern. So to have a state of balance, to have an efficient posture which provides and allows for efficient function, you need to have a posture that is built on a stable foundation. In addition, your base of support needs to anticipate movement. I live many years in California. We have something out there called earthquakes. Things move when earthquakes happen. Homes move when earthquakes happen. Houses move when earthquakes happen. And so you want to make sure that your house or bridge that you happen to be driving over when the earthquake happens is able to anticipate movement without disrupting the structure above. So I can stand perfectly aligned with my feet side by side, but if my feet are side by side and I want to reach out in front of me, my base is not anticipating that forward motion. Therefore, that puts excessive stress and demand on my system. But if I have my base positioned where my base is anticipating movement in that direction, now there's no stress on my system because my base of support is driving the motion. So not only do we want a good base that can support the structure, we want a good base that can anticipate movement. And what we will discover is when we have those in place, a good and efficient base actually helps to promote optimum neuromuscular function. So look at the blocks. Greg put these together many years ago when he was first looking at how to appropriately influence the structure of a patient based on soft tissue mobilization. But they give us a good understanding of how to visualize the way a system should work when you think about base of support in relationship to its structure. If a base is appropriately positioned, the structure above can balance on it. But when a base has a crack or is dysfunctional in its position, the structure above will reflect that same dysfunction. So now that we've talked about our base of support and how important it is, let's actually just stand up for a moment, stretch your legs because you've been watching this video, and I want you to look at me and follow me as we go through this lab. I want you to start out by just standing in place and noticing how do you stand on your feet. Do you feel more weight on one side than the other? Do you feel your knees are hyperextended or slightly relaxed? Do you feel your pelvis is anteriorly positioned or balanced, sitting efficiently up on top of the hips? Do you feel your head is forward or back? Just notice what is your natural standing posture. And now let's look at how just altering a base can change the entire posture. Drop your right foot, just at the foot and ankle, into pronation. And notice now what happened to the entire rest of your body. And notice not only what happened in terms of just standing in this posture, but now attempt to weight shift side to side with that foot in pronation. And notice the stresses and the compensations that are set up in your system because of that simple change in your base of support. Now take it back to its efficient position and shift side to side. Now go back and pronate again and shift side to side. A very simple illustration of how changing just the base can completely alter not only the alignment, but the function of the system above. So, now what we're going to do is talk about the second principle, alignment. The first thing to know is that efficient alignment is not determined by an anatomical chart, because that would just make everyone that has scoliosis or kyphosis of everyone, just they have no luck of having an efficient alignment. Efficient alignment is determined by each individual's ability to translate force through their system, to anticipate and be able to manage the ground reaction forces as they come up through the system with every step they take when they're walking or running. It's not meant to look the same for every person because every body's structure is different. So we define an efficient alignment as a state of balance in which the structures relate efficiently one to another. Here's the key, look at the bottom of bullet 2, in relationship to gravity, and bullet 3, promoting optimum weight transference. Now notice the final bullet, the same as the final bullet under base of support. When I have an efficient alignment, just like I have an efficient base of support, I get a more efficient activation of my muscular system. So it enhances my neuromuscular control. Look at this precious picture. This is Nico. Nico is the son of one of the gentlemen that came and completed his fellowship in Steamboat Springs. When Christopher was preparing to come out for his fellowship, Nico was around 6 months old, and Christopher sent the picture and said, "I want you to see a picture of my son." I immediately wrote him back and said, "Christopher, can I put Nico in my BET PowerPoint?" And he says, "Well, yes, why?" I said, "Because he's perfect." I said, "I want you to look at this picture," is what I tell everyone in my class. So I'm asking you, as you're watching this presentation, I want you to look at this picture of Nico, and I want you to tell me who taught him how to contract his transverse abdominis, or how to hold his core stable, so that he could maintain that perfect alignment that he is sitting in. No one. He does it because it's automatic. It's what our body's meant to do. But it's the years of abusive and dysfunctional postures and movements that we adapt as human beings that mess us up. It's not always what we're born with. Nico illustrates that when I sit in a balanced alignment over an efficient base of support, I have efficient control. Look at how he turns his head while sitting here without changing his alignment. Perfect illustration. And now look at these two ladies walking. I love this picture. This was sent to me by a friend who went over to Africa. And she sent back these pictures, and I immediately said, "Can I use this picture?" Because it's a perfect example of translating force efficiently. I want you to especially pay attention to the person on the left. I want you to look at the stride of her gait, the swing of her arms as she's carrying not 15, not 25, but 100 pounds on her head. And yet it looks like she's out for a daily stroll with her best friend because her alignment is allowing that weight to translate efficiently through her system to her base of support. How do we know if someone's in an efficient alignment? How do we know if they have a good base? In the early 1980s, Greg began to notice a correlation between someone's alignment and this stabilization that we were beginning to explore. This thing called let me brace or stabilize or something that will help me have better control of my back and take care of my back pain. And he began to see that certain patients automatically demonstrated an ability to stabilize. For others, it was an effort to stabilize. So in the early 1980s, he began to look at and research, going so far as to actually do a small research project with a physician on runners, looking at the absence or presence of this naturally occurring automatic engagement of these patients' core. And what he found was those patients that had bad alignment when they or had back pain when they ran, they were rigid and they were also unstable. You could see movement, but not movement in an efficient way. But runners without back pain and with efficient alignment, they tended to run with a good dynamic stability in their spine. And he said, well, how do I know if that's there? What can I do to test that? What can I do to tell me, myself as a clinician, that someone does or does not have the presence of this protective mechanism? So he developed a test called the lumbar protective mechanism test, which you will learn in your weekend course. It was an ability to him for him to put his hands on a patient and to push and see and test and determine if they had an automatic appropriate response to his external force. So he called this response the lumbar protective mechanism. And this lumbar protective mechanism is now something we also refer to synonymously as ACE, or an automatic core engagement. Because you see, a lot of people are talking about core. That word's been around since the early 1980s. A lot of people talking about get your core to come in. But a lot of people are teaching you to get it to come in volitionally. In the Institute of Physical Art, our entire approach is to create a structure, an alignment, and strategies of movement that allow for an automatic core engagement. So once again, another picture sent to me by a friend when the big storm hit a couple of years ago, the East Coast, and he sent me the picture just to show me how much snow they have because they weren't used to having a lot of snow. I immediately called up and said, can I put this in my PowerPoint? He said, well, yes. I said, look at your neighbor. Look at how your neighbor is pulling the children on the sled. Perfect alignment. And do you think he's out there pulling those kids thinking about his back? No. He found the position of his spine that allowed him to generate the most efficient force to pull those children on that sled. That's what the lumbar protective mechanism is. It's an automatic engagement of our core. It's a functional core, one that kicks in automatically when needed, in and out, as we are having demands placed upon our system. You're going to learn in your weekend course, you're going to learn how to teach your patient strategies that will allow for that automatic core engagement. All right, so when we are assessing this, we have to remember this is a neuromuscular response. Therefore, let's tie this back in with what we talked about earlier. Neuromuscular means initiation, strength, and endurance. So when we are assessing this coming weekend when you're taking your class, when we are assessing their lumbar protective mechanism, you will learn to assess its initiation, its strength, and its endurance. So we don't stop there. We have now base of support, alignment, and the lumbar protective mechanism. Before we move on to the last two principles, I just want to draw your attention to this next slide. The lumbar protective mechanism is primarily influenced by three things. Look at the number one thing on that list, base of support. Look at number two, alignment. Then look at number three, muscular strength and responsiveness. What that tells you as a core first therapist, as a functional manual therapist, is that my goal is not just to have them become strong in their dying bug exercises. Because I can be strong all day doing exercises on the floor and get up and in my functional activities have no core present at all. None at all. One of my good friends back in California was Mr. California in bodybuilding 3 years in a row. You can picture that. He was huge and he was strong. And yet I could stand him in a position and I could test for his lumbar protective mechanism where we push against his shoulders and he would bend every time and he would get mad at me because little old me could almost push him over. And then I would position him in an appropriate alignment over an efficient base of support and a freight train wouldn't knock him down. He was so strong. What I'm saying is it's not just about the strength of one's muscles. It's about the ability to have access to that strength. Yes, we need to make sure our patients have the strength, the initiation strength and endurance, but they need the core first strategies that give them access to that strength during activities of daily living. So when we're assessing our patient's lumbar protective mechanism, we're looking at our patient's strength response in response to external force. The key places we'll often see dysfunction will be at the pelvis, at the lumbar spine, and at the shoulder girdle, as well as the TL junction. These are areas where we will find our biggest dysfunctions. You will learn in your weekend course tests, such as the elbow flexion test, the lumbar protective mechanism test, that will give you the ability as a therapist to determine the presence or absence of this lumbar protective mechanism in your patient. So we've covered base of support, alignment, lumbar protective mechanism, talking extensively about the fact that the lumbar protective mechanism's presence is dependent on an efficient base of support and alignment. But then you want to move your system in space. That involves the principle of weight shift. You see, weight shift is not simply movement. Weight shift is the movement of an appropriate alignment over an efficient base of support. When I move efficiently with my body, there's no distortion in my alignment because my base is driving the motion. Weight shift will become a very important principle as we get into our active activities of daily living, such as active sitting, lifting, pushing, pulling in your weekend course. Weight acceptance brings us full circle. We started with base of support, and we will end with base of support. Weight acceptance means you bring all of your weight into your base of support and let the ground reaction force of accepting your weight into your base generate a response of your LPM. We're going to learn in your weekend course that weight acceptance is the key principle for you to train your patient in to have appropriate strategies for activities such as lifting and pushing and pulling. So we're going to learn in your weekend course these strategies, how to teach these strategies, but we're also going to do a lot of exercises because, as I said earlier, you do need all the muscles of the body to be able to initiate appropriately and have strength and endurance. You see, and it's not just about having a program directed at just this one part of our body. We're going to strengthen your arms and your legs and all of your trunk muscles because that's what's required for efficient strategies and activities of daily living. So we combine our strategies of training with our exercise program. And our exercise program, there are five major categories. Coordination. I like to think that coordination is the most important at all. Because it seems to me that I can be really, really strong, really, really flexible, just have good overall endurance, but I can still be not have a lot of coordination or control and therefore not have access to that strength. One of my best examples was a situation one time I was skiing with my brother, who back in these days was super strong, worked out all the time, and had a wife who was not that big of a person. And we went skiing together, and because they were a novice skiers, she was falling a lot, and she would fall down, and he'd be over there struggling, trying to get her to stand up on her skis, and they'd be falling all over each other and laughing and everything, and I'd come skiing down the mountain, and I'd ski up over and reach down and pull her right up, and oh, and my brother get frustrated, because he knew I was half his size and half as strong as him, or probably a third as strong as him. How did you do that, he would say, and I go, I don't know, she just came right up. And it had nothing to do with my strength. It had to do with my coordination, how I used my body related to the strategies we just reviewed. So our exercises during your weekend will cover coordination. We'll look at flexibility. I like to say that you could write the book on body mechanics, but if you don't have good flexibility, you can't perform good body mechanics. So flexibility is key for our patients to know where are they tight and how do certain restrictions greatly impair proper strategies for posture and movement. We're going to look at and understand that probably the most important joint for us to address in terms of flexibility is the hip joint in our patient. It's the number one joint to become tight as we get older. The number one motion we begin to lose as we get older is internal rotation in the hip joint, and we're going to see how that can impair our strategies for function. But we're not going to look at just passive stretching. We're going to learn how to do active elongation in your weekend studying core first strategies. We're going to look at stabilization, as I've said earlier, but we're not going to look at it from just a volitional perspective. We will do volitional bracing exercises to make sure the muscles have strength. That's just like taking a track runner and putting him on a treadmill or putting him on weight machines and having him strengthen his muscles, but you just don't stop there. You then make him run around the track. We'll do exercises to make sure the muscles are strong, but those exercises will then be incorporated with our strength and endurance exercises into functional activities to make sure the strategies for proper ADL are present. So our exercise program designed to impact change. Is there evidence to support the need for exercise? Absolutely. This is just a small list of all the research and researchers that are looking into the critical role that exercise plays in the restoration of function and the elimination of pain in patients with low back pain. So, what are our core first strategies? That means that as physical therapists, we need to facilitate an automatic core engagement through the proper training of coordination, through initiation, strength, and endurance of both local and global muscles, as well as synergistic strategies of combined use. This is our role as a core first therapist. You're going to need your exercise program to be demanding. I'll never forget, in early 1980, I had bilateral knee surgery at the same time. I was skiing, tore the ACL on one, meniscus on the other. They operated on both knees. And I've always been a very active person, but I had two young children at the time. And all I could think about is I want to go backpacking this summer with those kids. And so I was given an exercise program with a sport cord. And I want you to know that every day, 6 out of 7 days for 4 months, whether I was on the road or at home, I exercised because I wanted my knees well enough to hike me up the mountain and back. And yet when I was 22, I hurt my back for the first time. And in hurting my back for the first time, before I learned all these principles, my back just got worse and worse over the years. And do you think I gave the same effort to exercising my back that I gave my knees? I mean, think about it. I can replace both knees in a heartbeat, but I've only got one spine. And it took going to a course with Dennis Morgan and Eileen Volowitz and Michael Moore and being pushed and pushed and pushed to a level I'd never been pushed before in terms of my back exercises, that I realized I needed an attitude adjustment. I needed to realize that my back was not just as important as my knees, it was more important. And that I was putting too low of a demand on my patients to push themselves to exercise at the level that would give them an efficiently functioning, pain-free back. So is your program demanding? Do you send your patient home with 3 sets of 10? Or do you tell them to go home and do it for 10 minutes or 5 minutes based on the functional activity they have to go back to? Sure, my demand on my 83-year-old woman who's had bilateral hip replacement and multiple fractures in her spine, or my 83-year-old dentist who has, you know, had a stroke and also has a little Parkinson, but then also had a bad back, they're going to be different than my 35-year-old athlete who runs, you know, 40 miles a week. But I still put a demand that pushes them to their optimum performance, to their optimum potential. Don't be weak. If I gave you the diagnoses that I live with, if I told you every pathology that I have in my body, you'd be scared to give me any exercises. And yet I get in there and exercise with the best of them. You see, I don't want someone looking at me as a 57-year-old woman with all these pathologies and say, oh no, you shouldn't do that. I want people looking at me and saying, you know what? You can do this. So is your program demanding? Do you push your patients hard enough? We're going to be looking at that in your weekend course. We're going to be pushing you, because if you don't learn how to be pushed, just like me, you won't, in reciprocation, push your patients. So are your expectations high enough for your patients? How do you know how to set your expectations? Well, you better know your patient's goal, history, their strengths, their weaknesses, and know their attitude about pain. You gather all this through your evaluation. Now, BET approach to evaluation, or the core first strategy approach to evaluation, is not extensive in your weekend course. We build on and depend on the fact that you come to this program or to this course with a very good understanding of how to do a subjective and objective evaluation of your low back patients. However, there are certain components of the evaluation, especially the subjective and a few objective components, that are very critical to you as a core first therapist. We're going to talk for just a moment about these components that you need to think about. Number one, is your patient's understanding of pain and their relationship to their pain. Butler and Mosley have done so much for our profession. I look at them as important and creating such a landmark in our understanding in our profession as I look at someone like McKenzie or Johnson with soft tissue mobilization. I think of these people as making changes to our profession that change the way we treat our patients. And Butler and Mosley's knowledge and understanding of pain and what they've brought to us is so amazing. Their ability to now analyze a human's understanding and relationship to pain has transformed our treatment of patients with pain. If you have not studied with Butler and Mosley, I strongly suggest you do. But what's important to understand is that in their assessment of pain, when they look at someone, the first thing they make the patient understand is that the pain is in the brain. What do we mean by the pain is in the brain? First of all, you have to be careful, because you don't want a patient thinking you're telling them it's all in their head, when in actuality it is all in their head. You see, we don't really have pain receptors, and you'll talk about this more in the course. But the understanding that your patient needs to gain is it's their interpretation of sensory input that is manifested as a belief in pain. It's their perception that there is a threat to their system, so that when they are hurt, it could be a major injury, and they just shrug it off because they don't see the major injury as a threat. And then you could have a very minor injury and they're freaking out because they don't understand it. So when a patient gets back pain, if they understand, oh, my back's hurting, yeah, that means I probably need to change my position or this, or I need to stretch or put a lice on or maybe do something, they don't freak out. They're not threatened by the pain. But especially someone who's never really had pain before or tends to anyway be a person who's emotionally attached to pain, the minute that they get pain, instead of objectively understanding the pain, they let it consume them and their body's interpretation of the threat is magnified. Let me give you two examples. Number one, when Mosley first started studying this issue of pain, he had a patient that came in that he was evaluating, and this gentleman had an amputation just below the elbow. Several years before, he'd worked in a really large bread plant where they made bread every day. And one day at work, his hand was caught in an industrial size roller, sucked under the roller, crushed, and they had to amputate the arm below the elbow. Well, after much rehabilitation, obviously he couldn't go back to his job. He and his family moved. He quit his job there, and about, you know, they had moved about maybe 5 weeks before Mosley saw him in the clinic. For several years after the injury, after the rehabilitation, this gentleman had had no real pain. But all of a sudden, about 5 weeks ago, once they had moved into this new home, he started developing pain again. And he couldn't understand. He wasn't doing any activity that should cause the pain. He wasn't allergic to anything in the house that should set off an inflammatory response. But he'd wake up every morning with pain. So Dr. Mosley asked him to go home and keep a diary of everything he noticed for 3 days. And he came back in on the fourth day and he told him, he says, oh my goodness. He says, I realized it. Every morning I wake up, the first thing I smell is my neighbor making bread. And the very smell of my neighbor making bread created a tremendous phantom pain in his arm. Now think about that, guys. Just the smell of bread caused his pain. There's another great study that was one of those medical studies that you know, they talk about in the Wall Street Journal. One year, about a year and a half ago, I read. They took three groups of people, and they took their circulating level of antibodies in all three groups. And then they put them in three different rooms. One group watched a movie like Bambi or Little Mermaid. Nothing really too violent or bad, just happy movie. Another one watched Saving Private Ryan, a lot of violence and blood and gore. And the other one watched Outbreak. Immediately after the films, they tested their circulating antibodies again. And guess what? The group that had watched Outbreak had elevated levels of circulating antibodies. Wow, what does that tell you? That tells you that the brain, just from watching a movie, perceived a threat and changed the whole way it functioned and operated the human body. So how powerful is the brain? When you talk about this in the class, you'll understand more, but you need to get David Butler's book, Unexplained Pain. And another great book that will be a resource to you is one written by Cheryl Wardlaw called Taming Pain, which helps you understand not only what is causing our perception of threat, but how to deal with the inflammatory processes that can be set up. So how do we set our expectations? We know our patient's goals by doing a thorough evaluation, which we will talk about in our course. We know our patient's goals. We understand the activities of daily living that they have to go back to. If you look at Matt, this year that this picture was taken, he won the all-round gymnast gold medal at the Olympics. Do you think that growing up, he had people going, oh, no, you're exercising too much. Oh, no, you don't want to do that. You can't do that. No. You know how he won that gold medal? It's because he set his expectations way up here. He didn't let anyone ever convince him he couldn't do it. And you may say, oh, but that's the Olympics. Well, see, I see every day for my patients is an opportunity to win a gold medal at the Olympics in life. Because if you live with pain, your life's not worth anything. It just becomes very depressing. It limits you in what you can do. It takes away the joys of your life, interacting with your children, doing activities and sports you enjoy. When you set your expectations high, you give your patients hope. And that's what we need to do. We need to be able to look at our patient through our evaluation, come up with mutual goals. So in doing this, what I like to do is to remember a quote that's up on the screen now from an unknown author that says, "He who works with his hands is a laborer. He who works with his hands and his mind is a craftsman. He who works with his hands, his mind, and his heart is an artist." So what is the art? What is the art? Are you meant to be an artist as a physical therapist? Yes, we believe so in the Institute of Physical Art. You see, Portney and Watkins say that making clinical decisions in the face of uncertainty and variability is part of the art of clinical practice. And Sackett states that without clinical experience, practice risks being tyrannized by the evidence. You see, the art of physical therapy is the integration of your knowledge and evidence with your intuition developed by a results-driven clinical practice. You need to study the evidence. You have a large bibliography that we've given to you that goes through all the underlying research related to back education and training. You need to read those articles, and you need to read them properly. You don't read an article by just reading the abstract. You need to read the whole article, analyze the clinical appropriateness of the methods, compare the conflicting evidence that's out there, measure the evidence against your clinical experience so you know what evidence really applies to the type of patients that you see. Draw your clinical conclusion, not just the stated conclusion. And get involved. You can do clinical research. Do a case report. Do a simple study. Measure the results of a handful of patients. The more you challenge yourself to look at your results, the more you will challenge yourself to become better. So in conclusion, this introduction to your weekend course on core first strategies for posture and movement has been to share with you evidence that's out there, talk to you about how that evidence supports what we're doing, how it challenges us to think outside of the box. Looking at how core first strategies depend on the other aspects of functional manual therapy to establish efficient mechanical mobility, good neuromuscular control, good motor control. These are the things that you will be learning in your lab intensive course with your IPA faculty. I would like to leave you at the end of this video with a thought to enter into not only your weekend for core first strategies, but prior to that and after that. You see, one of the things that's very important to remember is that this course is about changing the way people use their bodies. It's about changing their postural and movement strategies. It's about changing the way they live. Something that I tell my patients is that, and something that I tell myself and every student that I teach, is that one can only teach what they know and do. You must become what you expect of your patients. The reason that I became an expert in core first strategies, the reason that I developed so many of the things that are now taught in core first strategies for posture and movement, is because I had a lot of injuries when I was growing up. I had a very bad back and a very bad neck. And yes, I had a very wonderful husband who was a great manual therapist who could treat me and get rid of my pain. But of course, when I used my body wrong, it would just come back. And luckily, I had a husband who loved me enough one day to say he would not treat me anymore because he knew that I was on the path to surgery, that I needed to take responsibility. That changed my life. But you know what? It didn't just change my life. It changed the life of every patient I saw from that day forward because I realized that everything I learned, I could share. But it wasn't just sharing now from a point of knowledge. I was sharing from passion because the things that you're going to learn in your weekend of core first strategies will change your life. And when they change your life, you won't be able to wait to teach them to your patients. Thank you very much, and we will see you soon.